bit of excitement this morning. I don't know how many of you felt the earthquake, but I can tell you it was felt as far west as my old hometown of Terryville, Connecticut, which is 20 miles west of Hartford. So Tony told me it was centered in New Bedford. So.
What was that, the earthquake?
Yeah, I didn't feel it either. Not everybody did.
What time was it?
It was about 12 past 9.
Yeah, earthquake. Well, we all survived it, and it's a great day. Warm, sunny, and anything this time of year that's warm and sunny, we are ahead of the game. We will take it. Let's begin now with our call to worship. Give the king your justice, O God. May he judge your people with righteousness and your poor with justice.
May the mountains yield prosperity.
In his days, may righteousness flourish and peace abound until the moon is no more.
He has pity on the weak and the needy, from oppression and violence he redeems their life. Their blood is precious in his sight.
You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Sometimes it's hard for us to focus on you. It's easy for us to become distracted by cares and concerns, by our to-do lists, and even by the fun parts of life. Help us clear the decks. Help us open our lives to your message. This we pray in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Lift up your lives.
We lift
them
unto the Lord.
O Lord, open our hearts.
Amen.
peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Mingle a little bit. Socially distant mingling. Well, in a couple of days, it's going to be Veterans Day. Originally, it was Armistice Day on the 11th day of the 11th month at the 11th hour. The guns fell silent on the Western Front in the First World War. The war to end all wars. Nice try. Didn't happen. So we've had a lot of veterans since then, a lot of conflicts, a lot of wars. We recently had an election in the United States, and one reason why we can have an election is because of veterans. Kept our freedom. So, we're going to honor them by reading their names, and Kim is going to do that honor for us.
Colonel Philip H. Pope, Army, World War II, Italy and Germany. David Pope, Navy, World War II, South Pacific. Kenneth LaPierre, Army, World War II, Australia. David Nyer, Vietnam. William T. Simpson, Air Force, Korean Conflict. June Stonier, Marines, World War II, Paris Island. Wilbert Marsh, Navy, World War II, South Pacific. Barbara Marsh, Marines, World War II, Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. William H. Brock, Army, World War II. Heather Inkley, Army, Otis. Preston Inkley, Army, Kuwait. Paul Perchard, Navy, Korea and Vietnam. Ken Goodwin, Marine Corps, Vietnam. Richard Kroll, Sr., Army. Robert Kroll, Army. Charles Kroll, Army. Kevin Inkley, Marine Corps, Okinawa and San Diego. Ernest Ray, Jr., Navy, South Pacific. Edwin Sutter, Army, World War II, Europe. Bill Sims, Navy, Korean War. Jeff, the husband of Reverend Dorothy Green, Army Air Corps, World War II, Panama. Alfred J. Johnson, Navy Seabees, World War II, Korea. Roland Barker, U.S. Air Force, U.S., North Africa, and Korea. Ferd Baxter, Army, World War II, 39th Hospital Unit, New Zealand. Mark Amidon, Army, Vietnam, Fort Riley, Kansas. James Harbison, Navy, World War II, South Pacific. Leo Babineau, Navy, World War II, South Pacific. Jason Borgatti, Marine Corps, Bosnia, Kuwait, and Somalia. Gordon Hazard, U.S. Air Force, 2.5 years, Mideast Asia and North Africa. Are there any other veterans we'd like to remember today?
As far as announcements go, just want to let you know that we've been working on this and planning it, and we're going to continue this year with our tradition of having a Thanksgiving dinner, which will be free, except it'll be different because everything this year is different. And we've Dave and Lynn have been in contact with the West Dennis Health Department, and they have okayed us to serve dinner by handing them out. Okay? Nobody comes in the building. People are going to be signing up for a time. They drive by, we hand them a dinner, they drive away. Okay? There's going to be some more on that. I think Lynn or Dave has some more ideas, and there's sign-up sheets and stuff. So.
Okay, we have a flyer that if anybody has an opportunity to put up around town, this is one of our best ads. It's traditionally we do this all the time. And we made some little tickets so that church number with them when they see the flyer. It goes at post offices, senior centers, things like that. So if you want a couple today or one, whatever, I've got about 20 made up. We also have a sign-up list for donations as usual. This year it's very limited because we're you're not doing the full-blown meal, so we're looking at, we need 50 pounds of squash. Okay, peel is preferred. Some gravy fixings, which is carrots, celery, and onions, and turkeys. Basically, the rest of the stuff David will purchase, and that's it. And we decided to do spice cake this year instead of pies. It's a lot cheaper. And we decided that, you know, usually we have a good donation jar. We're not sure what we're going to get this year for donations. So I did put at the bottom that if anybody does want to donate, they can give the donation give to either Prue, Mindy, or Pastor David. Any questions on that?
We'll have that out in the narthex after.
And I just want to add real quick, after Mass, real quick, if anybody who would like to hear what the health department had to say and how we operate under their guidelines, anybody who wants to volunteer, gladly walk everybody through it, because I mean, obviously, we'd be doing it differently. Batted around with them as to what and how we would do it, and they were very comfortable with it. Honestly, so tried telling, you know, pointing out all the reasons and how, you know, how we would do it, what we had for different ideas. They walked them back with us. So if anybody wants to talk about it afterwards, we'll do it after the end service.
Sounds like a good idea. Yeah. Later.
We also did, because people can also sign up for shut-ins to have deliveries, and we did have some conversation about that, about how to be careful about it. And we're asking everyone to get the phone number so that when the driver arrives at the residence, they'll call and we'll just put it outside the door. There's not going to be any contact.
Oh.
And if anyone has any better suggestions, we're willing to hear all suggestions. And then we're going to have a sign up for it that day. If folks that are here at the service would like just to pick up a meal or meals, they can pick them up through the kitchen door, and we'll have a separate sign-up list for that.
But we need people to sign up, because we're only going to make so many.
We're going to make 200, right?
Right. Yeah. And then it'll be a little wiggle room in case somebody right. shows and doesn't sign up, we'll still give them. But, you know, we'd like to have an idea. Any other announcements? Prayer requests, joys, concerns, celebrations?
I have a prayer request.
Okay.
My cousin Patty is a nurse who works in a nursing home in North Carolina, and they have been very hard hit by COVID. They've had to move all the 13 patients out because of COVID, because they contracted it. They lost, I think, at least three patients, and half the staff also has COVID.
Wow.
So my prayers are for her and the people at the nursing home.
Yeah. Once it gets in there. Someone else? Yes, Lynn.
I just wanted to mention how wonderful the thrift shop is going downstairs, and I think everybody here is aware of it, up and running, and a lot of the folks are here that are working on it, but it's done really, really well. I want to congratulate and thank them for all their hard work.
Yeah, it's a lot of work.
Really.
People are doing a lot of work. It's great. Anything else? Let's begin our section on prayer. The Lord be with you, and be with thy spirit. Let us pray.
O Lord, shall have mercy upon us,
and grant us thy salvation, and may clean our hearts within us. Let's be in a spirit of prayer. Holy One, we bless you for this day, and we have to admit that it's easy for us to bless you when it's sunny and warm and nice, and it's easy for us to bless you when life is pleasant and wonderful and people are kind to us, but we know that you are always there when the nights are dark and stormy. So we bless you and we try to sustain our faith, and we ask that you would sustain our faith so that we can find reasons to bless you come what may. We give you thanks for this day and for this church. We give you thanks for the people here. We give you thanks for their warm spirits, their generous hearts, and we give you thanks for the way that they try to make a difference in the world. For you have said, feed my sheep. And we are feeding your sheep in a literal sense, and then also in a spiritual and emotional and intellectual sense. So we give you thanks, and we are doing our best, and we ask that you would help us. Help us to be strong in our faith. Help us to work for your values and to witness for the love and the truth and the graciousness that you seek to bring to every person. Holy One, we pray for our country. Wow. We just had an election, and we're not sure if everything's going to go smoothly in the transition. But we pray that you will pour out a spirit of peace and harmony on the American people, because no matter what's going on, it's pretty evenly divided. And that's fair enough. That's why we have elections. But we ask that one half will not hate the other half, that people can disagree without being disagreeable. And we ask that there would be a peaceful transition. Holy One, we pray for this world. We pray for peace on earth. We pray for prosperity for people to have enough. And we pray that hearts would turn to you and with hope, and that people would think beyond themselves, beyond their own lives, and beyond their own little worlds, and consider what a wonderful world you have created. And consider that you love all people as your cherished children, which means that we are all sisters and brothers. Help people to recognize that. Help people to make that part of their being and their thoughts and their words and how they live. Lord, everyone here has hopes. Foster them. Help people do whatever it takes to bring themselves closer to their hopes and make those hopes real. And everyone here has talents. Help people discover talents they might not know, or help people find the confidence to fully employ the talents that they do have. Everyone here has cares and concerns. Lift them up. Pour your grace upon them so that somebody who's sick is sustained. Somebody who's headed in the wrong direction turns around. And somebody who's just plain down is lifted up. Holy One, people have told us that you never give us more than we can handle. And yet that's not always true. What we would say to that is that you never give us more than we can handle with faith and with our community of friends and family. So we give you thanks that you have called us into this church, called us into this family of faith. In all things we give thanks to Jesus Christ our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Plates by the doors, and I presume you know that. So let us give thanks to God and dedicate these gifts unto the Lord's service for everything we have received from God. And everything we have is a blessing. So help us to bless others with our gifts and our time and our talent and our treasure. And we dedicate all of these things in the service of God, and the service of this church, and the service of God's people everywhere. Amen.
Thank you.
scripture reading is from Psalm 72. This is a coronation hymn. It was part of the ceremony in the temple when they crowned a new king, and it articulates to people's hope for the new king. They hoped the new king would be righteous. They hoped the new king would look after everybody. And if you look back on the history of the kings from some of the earlier books in the Bible, you know that they didn't always get that. Let us hope that our election has brought us a ruler of justice and dignity. Give the king your justice, O God, and your righteousness to a king's son. May he judge your people with righteousness and your poor with justice. May the mountains yield prosperity for the people and the hills in righteousness. May he defend the cause of the poor of the people. Give deliverance to the needy and crush the oppressor. May he live while the sun endures, as long as the moon throughout all generations. May he be like rain that falls on the mown grass, like showers that water the earth. In his days may righteousness flourish until peace abounds and the moon is no more. For he delivers the needy when they call, the poor and those who have no helper. He has pity on the weak and the needy, saves the lives of the needy, saves them from oppression and violence and redeems their life. Precious in his sight is their blood. Gospel this morning is Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. Jesus is coming to the end of his life, and he's talking about the second coming, when he promised to return to earth and bring God's ways and God's realm to earth completely, entirely, and in a tangible manner. Okay? Well, he also said something that confused a lot of people when he said at some point, some of you living now will not taste of death before you see this happening, before you see this coming. Well, they thought he meant the kingdom of heaven would come in entirely, it's the second coming. But what he meant was that you would see the beginning of it, which was clearly shown in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Okay? In another section, he talked about the second coming, and he said, but no one knows about that hour and about that day, not even the Son, only the Father. So if Jesus didn't know when it was going to happen, nobody else does. But the concern here in this parable is how we are to live our lives in the meantime, today. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout. Look, here's the bridegroom. Come out to meet him. Then all the bridesmaids got up, trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise said, no, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves. When they went out to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open up to us. But he replied, truly I tell you, I did not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Join me now in sermon prayer. Blessed Lord Jesus, guide us as we seek to follow the road that you have set before us. Help us as we make our way through this world. Give us courage when the way is rocky and steep. Give us hope when the nights are long and dark. Keep our hearts grounded in your message. Let us hold fast to the good and release all darkness. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Well, a few things about the customs of that time and place. Because when we hear the parable, it's a little strange, a little unusual. We wonder what's going on. The custom was that the guests would assemble at the bride's family's home. And they would be entertained by the bride's family until they waited for the groom to arrive. And of course, everybody has a watch now, and everybody knows what time it is all the time. But in those days, they were pretty loose about these things. And when the groom approached, they liked to do this in the dark so that the procession would be so much more dramatic with the lights and the lamps. When the groom approached, they lit their lamps and torches and went out to greet him. Okay? Then they all processed together to the groom's family's house for the ceremony and the banquet. And what they would do is they would take the longest way they could so that everybody who wasn't going would have a chance to see. And it was just to make it really special. Okay? That's what they did. Now, one of the customs and the laws was if you were out after dark, you had to have a lamp with you, a candle or a lantern or one of those little olive oil type lamps. That was the rule. And the custom also was when they got to the groom's house and the ceremony began, the door was shut. Nobody was allowed in. That's just the way it was. Being late at a time like that was considered a gross insult. It was one of those things that was just not done. Okay? Now, people sometimes look at the parable and interpret it in a variety of ways, and that's one of the great things about parables, is you can look at it and come up with all kinds of meaning. And they're not, any of them usually not really wrong, it's just one more layer of the onion. So people sometimes look at the parable and interpret the groom to be the second coming of Jesus. And he's delayed. Because remember, people thought Jesus was coming back any minute because he said, some of you will not taste of death until that day comes. And we know that that's not how it worked and Jesus is still coming. So they were expecting that and they were wondering and waiting. And the bridesmaids, some were wise, some were foolish, some were prepared, some had the gift of planning ahead, and some just kind of let things happen. Well, people interpret that sometimes as members of the body of Christ, church members. And we all know that any church is a mixture of people with a variety of gifts, talents, and outlooks on life. Okay? And the banquet is a pretty frequent a symbol in the New Testament for heaven, for God's kingdom coming to this earth, for us after dying go to heaven, but also with the second coming and the fullness of God's love being made real here. So there's that. Some people look at the bridesmaids being locked out and say, that's the final judgment. I'm not too sure about that. Social customs of any given society, some of them are wonderful and some of them aren't, some of them point the way and some don't. But one thing that I do know is that one lesson this parable says to us is there's a time to do something. There's a time to do something, and once that time has passed, it's gone. Maybe forever. And I looked this quote up. I didn't have it. William Shakespeare. And I think it was Julius Caesar. And I looked that up too. I'm not trying to. He said, There is a tide in the affairs of man, which taken at the flood, leads on to fortune. Omitted, all the voyage of their life is bound in shallows and in miseries. So there's a time. And if that time is gone, it's not going to come back. I've seen this play out. You know, I've been a pastor for 25 years. Under certain circumstances, pastors are invited into people's lives. You see, the inner workings of a family, you know, and this is a lot of times it's at like peak moments, like a wedding. You really see how it works with the family and people and their hopes, or a birth and baptism. But also, you know, you're invited in the saddest moments, funerals, sort of thing. Now, funerals are always a hard time. You know, there's always grief. There's always a sense of loss. And even if the person was loved and everybody's squared away with it and they're accepting it, it's the end of an era and people mark the passing of time and it's change and there's hard times, okay? Now, it's not so bad if the people loved one another and everybody knew it. You know, people were able to say what they needed to say. And everybody knew what they were going to say, but the person just said it anyway. You know, I always love you, I always respect you. Oh yeah, I know. Okay? They didn't have to say it, but they did. But they said it just to say it. And it's wonderful if people can resolve long-standing conflicts. And we all know that's great when that happens, but we all know it's better if there aren't any long-standing conflicts. Well, it's very unfortunate is when people are stubborn and they can't admit they were wrong or they're too embarrassed or they didn't want to give them the satisfaction. You know, there's a lot of things. And it's also unfortunate when somebody wanted to tell somebody how much they loved them or wanted to apologize or wanted to express something, anything. And they meant to, but they just didn't find the right time. Or they just didn't get around to it. Now, when I was very, very new to ministry, I did a funeral for a woman who had like a number of daughters, I don't know, 4 or 5. And the youngest daughter never got along with her mother for a very good reason that the mother favored the other daughters. Okay, so the youngest daughter was not making this up. So, I'm doing the ceremony, and we're at the finished the funeral, we're going to the cemetery, and the older daughters are standing there, they're in there, okay. The youngest daughter was a mess. And I'm thinking, I thought she would be okay, because she never liked the old bird to begin with. Wrong. Then it dawned on me. The youngest daughter is having a hard time because there's no chance now of any kind of resolution, any kind of reconciliation, any kind of expression of affection or anything. So there's a time, and that time is gone. Let's say somebody's laid up for a week. They could use help. They can't get out of bed. Okay? Somebody calls 3 weeks later and asks if there's anything they need. Not so good. Or the classic example, a student who goofs off all semester, stays out late, skips classes, misses assignments, you name it, okay? He or she cannot accomplish a semester's worth of work, semester's worth of learning, in the final week of the semester. You know, there's papers they didn't write. Can they do them? Maybe. There's labs they needed to do. Cram for the final exam. That can't be done. The time had come, and the time had gone. So one lesson from this parable is, a word to the wise, thank somebody. Resolve the conflict. Apologize. Do that kindness. Help somebody out. Whatever it is, if there's something that is on your heart, why not now? It may be too late. You never know. Another way to look at this parable is to recognize that sometimes you need your own. I'm not talking about being selfish, I got mine, too bad for you. I'm talking about you need to have your own resources. Okay? Some of the bridesmaids had the foresight to bring enough oil, and some of them didn't. And the ones who didn't said, let us borrow some of yours. And the ones who had brought some said, no. Then nobody will have enough, and we'll get halfway over there and all the lamps will go out. Go to the stores. Go get some. Well, of course, the stores aren't open at midnight. Not then. So each bridesmaid need to have their own oil. Now, we could take oil and use that as an image for maybe faith. You know, spiritual resources. Okay? People need to have their own faith. You can't have somebody else's. People need to believe. They need to hope. They need to trust. The power of example is a wonderful thing. But when you look at somebody who has a lot of faith, somebody who's very strong in the faith, people looking at that same person, different people can come up with different conclusions about it. Someone might say, well, good for them. They have faith. I'm glad they believe, but I just can't do it. It won't work for me. Somebody else might say, wow, I wish I had faith like that. I wonder how they got there. I wonder how they came to believe. Now, maybe if we define faith, it'll help a little bit. It's a phenomenon that has several different components. There's the intellectual assent part of it, in which a person agrees. They agree with the ideas that the faith teaches. They accept it as true, and they accept it as being the truth, which is great. But that's only part of it, because there's no emotional commitment. There's no gut feeling. There's no dedication to it. So the other part of that would be if somebody goes to those intellectual assents and adds to that deep belief and trust, and they make that truth their own, and they cherish the insights, and they gain hope from them, and they welcome that truth, that belief, and that faith into every part of their life, into their mind, their heart, their soul, their spirit, and they base their life on it. They base their life on it. And this is what we mean by when we say that somebody is a person of faith. They have both those things, intellectual assent and deep belief and trust. We talked about saints last week or the week before. And that's what we were talking about. So, one, our faith teaches us that human life and human history has a purpose. And it has a goal. It's not random. It's not just an endless cycle of people going nowhere. It's just, okay, people are born, people die, people are born, people die, and, you know, life goes on the way, you know, like an oak tree does. Acorn falls off, it grows, and the oak tree dies, but there's another one. No, there's meaning here. Our faith teaches us that God has a plan for every life, each life, in the here and now. You are where you are for a reason. You are where you are because you have a purpose. Let's say that a coworker is sick. Okay, or not sick, because let's stay away from sick. We're all wearing masks and nobody gets sick. Co-worker's having a hard time, right? Nobody else in the office is a person of faith, but you are. You might be in that office to help that person with your faith. I'm not talking about getting them off into a corner and reading the Bible at them. I'm just talking about just that sense that people have. God has a plan for the ultimate future, both for individuals and collectively, for as a society, in this world and beyond. So, we can live with hope. We can live with hope that God will continue to reach out to this world, to continue to reach out and redeem people, and redeem situations and save people and the world through Christ's grace. Okay, now full disclosure here. Ministers use resources. There's books, there's websites. We don't, well, I don't lift sermons. I don't do it. That's intellectually dishonest and grounds for dismissal. And I heard of a guy in New Hampshire who had been preaching, and one of the deacons said, some of these phrases don't sound like him, and put a few of the phrases in there, and the sermon that he preached, that the minister preached, popped up. Whoops! He copied it from somebody, just the whole sermon. That's not what this is. But most of us use other resources other than, you know, because to just develop ideas and faith and things that we might overlook. So, you know, you want background information on the theology, insights from various disciplines. So how's this for timing? Looking through, for preparing for this Sunday, I found this quote from 2011. Some may be fearful about where human history is headed. Freedom and justice seem fragile in the face of oppression, violence, and injustice. Believers are not immune to the harsh realities of today. Our task is to live with confidence and hope, expecting that God will bring blessings and truth. Wow. Could have been written last week. That book was published in 2011. So we know Jesus is coming, but we know that Jesus is already here because he said, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. So Jesus is present when people live in hope and they never give up. When people express love and compassion, they work to make things fair. When people and the friends and family of critically ill people know they're safe. They're safe in God's love. And heaven breaks into earth when faithful people believe and put their faith into action. Sounds good, right? How are we going to do it? One way, and maybe this is because of the spirit of the times and the week. But one way is we can manage our own anxiety, and that way we can have the most positive effect. It's kind of like going to the doctor, right? You have a problem, and you want a positive outcome. Well, we have a positive outcome here because it's like, you know, you find out, you get a positive report. You don't need an operation, which is always good, and you don't need a medication that has side effects, because a lot of them do. Well, so that's a relief. And the doctor says, yep, no operation, no medication. You can fix this with diet and exercise. A lot of people go, oh, diet and exercise, can't you just give me a prescription? But actually, diet and exercise is the best thing. And that's wonderful news because that's within our control. We can do that. We can do something about it. Now, when we think about diet relating to food, mostly what we're talking about is eat this, not that, right? It's like the studies that say oatmeal has good effects on people's heart and it's healthier for you than bacon and eggs, right? Bacon, that's one thing, the oatmeal looks very good. You substitute something healthy for something less healthy, right? So what do we take into our lives? Have you heard the term doom scrolling? You know, it's a concept where people go on the internet. It's mostly on the internet, but scrolling. And they look up an alarming article. And it scares them. Or it makes them angry. Or it makes them hate the other side. And because it just goes both ways. Okay? So they do that. And it, like, one thing leads to another. And the problem with that is, first of all, it's depressing. It doesn't help you. And the second thing is your computer has algorithms, all these sites, so they know, oh, this guy, this person's interested in this. So you get more of what you look for. We can avoid negative or harmful material and input no matter where it comes. Okay, so we want to avoid that, but there's more to it than avoiding the bad. We want to embrace the good. Okay, so we want to praise it with something beneficial. Anything that changes the focus from hatred and strife. Of course, we want to avoid the darkness, but we want to seek out anything and everything that's uplifting. Find things that bring joy. Find things that foster hope. Now, The Bible, of course, would be my first recommendation. But I'm standing on Sunday morning giving a sermon wearing a robe. Of course, I'd say the Bible. But there's other things, too. Anything that makes you feel kinder, that gives you more compassion, anything that makes you feel closer to God. It's out there. The other half of that prescription, the doctor would say, was exercise. And by the way, if you're feeling anxious and stuff like that, physical exercise really is good. It's a wonderful antidote to stress and toxic aggravation that we're all feeling. But we're looking beyond the physical here, the psychological, the emotional, and the spiritual. So there's traditional Christian practices that are tried and true. They've been working for centuries. And one of them, these are all simple, by the way. One of them is to practice the presence. Now, practicing the presence means that recognizing that we're always in God's sight. We are always in the presence of God. And so one way that people practice this is to invite Jesus to walk beside them, whatever they're doing. And you can't keep your focus all the time, but sometimes you can. And to say, Jesus, I'm having a day here. Be part of my day. And recognize that as you live, you are in the presence of God. Some people do things like meditation, moments of calm. Doesn't have to be complicated. Doesn't have to be esoteric. Doesn't have to be woo-woo. You're about 2 miles from the ocean here. You can walk on the beach. People spend a lot of money to come here to walk on the beach. So you can do that. Or you can sit in a car and look out at the water. It's nice. Or any place you want, you can just sit and breathe. Just breathe. And you can ask, God, what do you want to say to me today? What do you want me to hear? And just sit there. 15 minutes. 10 minutes, 5 minutes, sit and breathe. You have a timer on your phone, set it. Some people find this, it's a very simple meditation practice. You breathe in, and as you breathe in, you think, only God. Hold it for a second, breathe out, and say, only good. So you're taking in only God and sending out only good. And then you breathe in, only light, and you breathe out only love. So you're taking in light, sending out love. Taking in God, sending out good. Taking in light, sending out love. And again, 15 minutes, 10 minutes, 5 minutes. There's no wrong way. If your mind wanders, if you forget, don't worry about it, bring it back. So there's a lot of ways. One main takeaway I would like you to have is that we can have enough oil in our lamps. We can have enough actual spiritual practices and spiritual experiences that we can be filled with the Spirit. Jesus is standing ready to come to us today. Amen.
Thank you.
Now in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, be filled with every grace, be filled with every joy, be filled with every hope. Be blessed, and wherever you go, be a blessing. Amen.